If you're an environmental activist, you have to be an optimist, I believe. I mean, I don't see how you could function, sleep at night, or do anything else if you thought, geez, we're all doomed and everything's awful and we're going to hell in a handbasket. I don't think there'd be any motivation to try and save land or change ordinances or get elected or do much of anything. I think activists fundamentally are people that believe things can get better and believe things can get better as the result of concerted action by either individuals or groups. Even though environmentalists get characterized as being against everything or being negative, in reality, I think they, by definition, have to be some of the most optimistic people. Well, my name's Jono Miller, and I've been working here at New College on and off. I guess my first job here was in 1971. My immediate family was very rooted in New Jersey. I grew up about 20 miles from Manhattan, and I went to the same grammar school my father attended. He met my mother when they were in baby strollers, so we all grew up roughly about 20 miles from New York City. Well, my father was a big explorer of the state. He had grown up, he would carry a shotgun on the way to school and hide it in a hollow tree and hunt on the way home. He was very interested in the natural world. He knew about fossils and plants and birds and arrowheads. And from about 6 to 13, every weekend my father and I would drive somewhere in the state and look for things or explore. I would hunt with my father. I was a hunter until probably age 18. I had a 20-gauge shotgun before I had a two-wheel bicycle. We'd get up very early in the morning, like 3 or 4, and drive down to South Jersey. We'd walk out before daylight and find a muskrat house out in the marsh to sit on. And my father's hearing was compromised because of the war, but he had excellent vision. And so he would sit on one side and tell me he could see ducks or geese coming, and I would sit on the other side and say I could hear them coming. And it was fascinating because dawn would break and the ducks would take off. My father told me that I needed to remember it because I would never see it again in my life. And the ducks would blot out the sky. You know, you couldn't really see the sky because the number of ducks flying around was so dense. And it was true. I've never seen that again. So I came to New College in 1970. Yeah, it was a pretty big change to leave suburban New Jersey, where I, you know, could take the train into New York City and to come to a place like Sarasota. Yeah, big change. It took me quite a while to really bond with this area. I had come from the temperate forests of the Northeast, of the Middle Atlantic states, and I had a beech tree outside my room that was enormous. We had giant sugar maples on our property, and so we were used to very substantial trees. And when I got down here, and the pine trees were short and kind of stunted looking, and palm trees didn't seem very significant, and a lot of sand spurs, and so It was not an instantaneous process of connecting with the landscape, but because of getting out and canoeing, exploring the state, it didn't take very long to develop a sense of place. I met Julie the first day I got to New College. We were in the same orientation group, and didn't get some memo or something. I ended up with a mattress and like no sheets and no blanket and didn't know what I'd done wrong. And I, in the orientation group, I'd learned that Julie had come to campus with a sleeping bag. So I had my cactus shipped down, but she actually had something useful. So I borrowed the sleeping bag from Julie, and that was sort of the beginning of our relationship. And we were both in this class, this environmental biology class together, and both had similar interests in the environment. So we ended up studying together, and we would go out and do water sampling or look at seagrass or whatever. Julie did her thesis on Upper Myakka Lake, And that's when I was first introduced to the Myakka River. And after we graduated, we were very involved in water. Our first job was working on a sort of an annotated bibliography of the Charlotte Harbor area. We were also hired to canoe the Myakka to see if it would be suitable for designation as a part of the state canoe trail system. And it was very difficult. At that time, there was no herbicide spraying of water hyacinth or water lettuce. So there were these big hyacinth jams. And we left Myakka River State Park and started canoeing downstream and got about a mile downstream, and it was just solid floating aquatic weeds. And so we got out of the, you know, it was like the African Queen or something. We were, one of us would be in front pushing the hyacinths aside and the others in the back pushing the canoe forward. As a result, even though the Myakka is a state wild and scenic river that was designated by the legislature, it's not part of the state canoe trail system because at the time it was surveyed, it wasn't really canoeable. And even today, frequently doesn't have enough water to paddle. And people will call up and say, can we canoe on the river? And the answer is, how fast can you drag your canoe? Julie and I, we worked on some of the earliest comprehensive plans of the county, and we actually determined what the habitats would be called. We got to name the habitats in Sarasota before the state of Florida tried to develop a comprehensive system that named all the habitats. It's been very helpful to have work with someone who not only understands what I'm trying to do, but is supportive and contributing and a partner in moving most of these campaigns. Couldn't have happened without Julie's support, so that's been crucial. We graduated in the spring or early summer of 74, and in the fall of 74, we led a 47-day canoe trip from Fort Meade on the Peace River down to Chokoleskye Island in the Everglades. And so that was an incredible opportunity to further bond and connect with the Florida landscape. But to do this 47-day trip, we had gone ahead and positioned supplies like 2 weeks apart in different communities along the way. But for a two-week period at a time, we wouldn't really have any contact with the outside world. We would just be our own little self-contained group moving either through rivers or bays as we kept paddling southward. So, it would be interesting to go back and redo that trip because a lot of places that we camped are now developed and you couldn't stay there. So it'd be interesting to compare. I was interviewed on TV one time, some sort of independent producer, and, he was asking pretty predictable interview type questions. And then he said something like, well, what's your conception of heaven? And I went, whoa. And then I said, heaven is canoe camping on a river. And every day you wake up and canoe down a stretch of the river and it's different than the day before. And then you camp and then you wake up the next morning and keep canoeing and it's different than the day before.